Hello, Monica Miller here. This is Legal Tuesdays, where I answer your questions about separation of church and state. This is our first episode under the new administration. Very pleased to see the former administration out of the White House. I'm hoping with the new administration, we can expect to see separation of church and state as a priority. At the very least, hopefully they do not undermine it in the same way that we saw the former administration do. That being said, are we off to the best start? No. This segment of Legal Tuesdays is going to be dedicated to the questions and concerns that we received in quite abundance regarding the inauguration. I even had one member text me saying, I'm confused, am I watching the US presidential inauguration or the Vatican TV? It was undeniably very religious. We saw invocations, we saw religious songs, we saw the oath itself with So Help Me God. And questions have arisen regarding, one, the appropriateness of using religion in a public event, and frankly, just outrage by many individuals who were hoping for a little bit more, less religion and more inclusivity for the vast, a very large and growing population of the country that doesn't believe in any god or gods. There's also many religious people who follow the scripture, for instance, the Bible that has the Sermon on the Mount. I've represented, Catholic, devout Catholic clients who are vehemently opposed to public prayer, to legislative prayer, any sort of public prayer because of the Sermon on the Mount, and them feeling like it is a violation of their religious principles to have an event where prayer is public. So this event rubbed people the wrong way, for sure, at least with respect to all of the religion that we saw throughout the day. Regarding its appropriateness, absolutely inappropriate for an event that is purporting to unify with the goal of unifying, again, to exclude people, to make them feel uncomfortable, to make so many of us just cringe and feel excluded because we don't believe in God, because we don't, want to listen to another invocation, during our day. It was very disappointing. Whether it's constitutional or not is another question. There is a lot of components to that, to answering that, and it's sort of a matter of what aspect of the event we're looking at. These inaugurations are publicly funded and privately funded, and there's speakers there that, Jennifer Lopez, Garth Brooks, that are not, speaking for the government. And it would be really hard to say that, Jennifer Lopez is speaking as a government at a ceremony that is both private and public in funding and in sort of who is putting it on. There's also the issue of standing. The Freedom From Religion Foundation brought a case under the Obama administration challenging just the oath of office, seeking to prevent the So Help Me God language from being uttered at the upcoming, at that then upcoming inauguration, on the idea that, again, it violates the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment to have an oath of office that requires, that says So Help Me God. It sort of makes it, it's not a requirement and it's not in the Constitution to have the oath with So Help Me God, but there it is. And so they unfortunately lost, not on the merits, but because of standing. They said they didn't have a particularized injury and there was no federal taxpayer standing. I won't go into the nuance of that, but suffice to say that even if we felt that there was a legitimate component of this celebration that violated separation of church and state, we might not even be able to get our foot in the door because of standing. Then again, there is the component of who is the speaker of the event. Arguably, many of the speakers there are there on their own terms. They might have even been invited by the, the private component of the ceremony. I believe the government funds the security and other secular components. Now, again, if this were a public school or not a federal government event, but all of this was taking place at a local public school, it might be very different. The government cannot, and there's Supreme Court cases that make it very clear that outside of this narrow legislative prayer concept, which is not what we're talking about at the inauguration, the government is prohibited from holding an event in which it invites prayer. So at a football game, for instance, the U.S. Supreme Court said that even when in Santa Fe versus Doe, even when a prayer is delivered by a student and it's student-led and student-initiated, it still violates the First Amendment when the event is a public school football game, where everyone that's there is there because the government, the school invited them and they're using, you know, it's a school game, they're in school uniform, it's on school grounds, kind of the whole situation is, it has the government's hands on it, even when the student, or, you know, even when the speaker is not the government. The inauguration is not set up that way. It's just a very different event entirely. So, you know, you won't see us bringing a case anytime soon, and I don't think you'll see any of the other big groups bringing a case anytime soon. If they do, we'll probably all join forces because it's the kind of case that, you know, would require a lot of woman power. I don't like saying manpower, but, you know, a lot of hands on deck. So that's all I have time for today, but please do send us your questions about separation of church and state, and I will be sure to answer them in the next segment of Legal Tuesdays.